Welcome back, Visions fans. Ready Player Will here. Today we're talking about Sweetheart Eldira that just came out this week. Brand new unit to Global. Was the Valentine's unit back on the side of JP, but got her a little delayed here this time of year. Regardless, better late than never. Nice to have new characters in the game. And this is kind of an interesting review because she is definitely a different character than I'm normally used to reviewing and probably than what you're used to seeing. So let's jump into things. The review breakdown today, it's going to be a character overview, the base stat analysis, and then just a very quick stat breakdown to show where the rest of them come from, then going over the full DPS report card, the unique evasion mechanic that she comes with, and my thoughts, and just a little bit in terms of what to expect and how to manage it, my general thoughts overall, and then the class of job overview I'll go through very quickly with some notable vision cards. I'm going to pass on the espers and weapon analysis because it's pretty straightforward and a little more situational at this point in the game. You can ignore the bullet there, I'm sorry. And then trust on recommendations to end things off. So getting into the character overview, brand new fire unit with the unique operative main job. They also decided to give her the Strider and Ranger sub jobs. She does equip ninja blades and equips hat, cloth, and accessories with a move of 3 and a jump of 2. In terms of resistances, elemental resists, normal to what you'd expect. For the weapon type resistances, overall not that bad. The only negative is the minus 15 to strike, missiles at 0 with 15, 10, and 5 to the others respectively. Overall, pretty good starting spot. Strike damage really is impactful in some situations, but not really something that you're normally worried about throughout the game, so it's really not that big of a weakness to try to hedge against. In terms of the resistance status ailment, she actually is a unit that I would keep at 97 faith. We're going to get into why in just a little bit here, and so because of that, you need to watch out what she can be affected by for status ailments, and she does have some resistance to charm and immobilize with 10% to sleep. Overall, not that bad. Charm you don't see a lot of yet, but it does have some future prevalence, and immobilize and sleep are slowly becoming more common, but aren't horribly detrimental overall, at least not compared to some of the others. Now we get into the base stat analysis, and again we look at these because a lot more things in the game scale off of base stats in terms of subvision cards, trust stone, passives, things of that nature. So from the HP perspective, the UR average right now is 2988 for base stat HP. She's a little bit below that at 2814. Now she is an evade unit technically, and she is in good company there in terms of other evade units. So you do see Violet 2B is a little bit higher, Farm, Elaine is down here at 70, so she's in decent company in terms of base HP for an evade unit. In terms of attack stats, she actually does do relatively well. The UR average of the, we'll say top half of the list, is 379. She's not as high as some of the others, obviously, sitting here at 396, but she does have a mastery ability that bumps it up so that her overall attack stat actually does get some decent levels, but overall enough base attack for certain. When it comes to agility, it's actually fantastic. She is the second fastest base agility character in the game at 64. So things that scale off of agility, she's going to get a little more than your average unit in terms of speed. So big thumbs up there. In terms of dexterity, basically average 198 on 199. So nothing too crazy in terms of critical hits. It does help her accuracy, but that's not her main source of accuracy overall. And then from a luck perspective, because she is an evade unit, she is above average, which obviously you would hope for, of 169. She's at 183, a little bit below what you'd expect in terms of some of the higher evade units overall, but we're at the state in the game now where there's a lot of external sources of evasion. It's not only on your luck stat, but would have liked to see it just a little bit higher. But as you can see, 183 is similar to what Elena and 2B have, so not a far cry from what some of the other decent evade units are, or great evade units are. And then just going over the high level stat breakdown, and I like to do this because it kind of closes the gap between base stats and the report card. So the very first top line here is her base stats that we all just went through. She does technically have some board stats here as well. She gets an extra 8 agility, a little extra luck here, 89 luck and 24 dexterity. She does get a board node that increases her attack as well, 79. And then her mastery ability also gives her an additional set of attacks. So she ends up at 634, which technically is the second highest innate attack in the game, only behind Thancred. So it does end up being relatively high because of the board node and the mastery. Now for the DPS report card overall, effective HP here, which again kind of balances the resistances and defense and spirit with the actual HP level itself to kind of give some normalization to the number. It is a C+. I'm kind of rounding up a little bit here. Probably could be a little bit lower. She is very, very squishy, and rightfully so as an evade unit. Most of them are, but she's a little bit below what some of the others have in terms of survivability. Against physical types, it's a C-, but a little of that is skewed because of the negative 15% to strike. If you kind of omit that part of it in the weighting of things, it actually ends up being a little bit better, but again, nothing great. It's still a C at best or C+. And the magic side of things, definitely a little bit better, if only because of the innate 6 spirit kind of tips the scale in her direction. But in terms of overall survivability as extra color to the HP stat itself. There is no innate AoE or unit resistance. She does have that 6 and 8 spirit, but no defense and no access to increasing either via her passives. She's got no courage, no re-raise, or reliable forms of self-healing, but she does have a 30% damage barrier, so that is kind of factored into the equation to somewhere at least as well, so something to keep in mind. From the primary stat, I am giving her an A, you know, if not an A plus even. The only reason why I kind of stayed at the A is because her base attack obviously is a little bit lower than the others, so she doesn't scale up on as much on some of the external sources of attack up, but overall it's definitely a thumbs up in terms of attack potency. Agility, I'm giving her an A, if not even higher, because of one of the mechanics in her kit. She has great base agility at 64, so she's going to scale super well with agility boosting things. 72 total. Unfortunately, no passives to increase it. The highest character with their passives ends up being at 75 and 76, so she's just a smidge below that. But overall, she is definitely a speedy unit. From an accuracy perspective, giving her an A-, she does have a great passive that gives her 25 accuracy in addition to some defense penetration, and she does have a sharpshoot potential on these sub-jobs, so there are a variety of ways in which you can gear it to hit some evasion. Overall, accuracy is not in a bad spot. The evasion overall, I don't even have a grade. I really don't have a grade, and I have a whole next slide and slide after to talk about why the evasion is so wonky, how to really understand it best, and we're going to go through some of how you can really leverage it to truly make her an evade unit. And finally, movement, I'm giving her an A minus. With a passive, she can get an extra move plus one, which is pretty awesome. So you can get up to move four, jump two, which is overall pretty great. From her passives, giving her an A, she actually does have some good passives that do have some variety to play with. There's some that are obviously best in a majority of situations, but she does have a couple that really would scale well with different kinds of maps and different kinds of metas. For her counter abilities, also giving her an A, she has a reflex ability, which is fantastic. The overall kit, I'm giving a B. I like it. I don't love it. There's definitely some downsides to it. For an overall final grade of B, and I know a lot of people really think she's bad, and in part because of the fire element by and large, and you're not terribly far off. But I'm also trying to keep everyone a little level-headed here, because we typically look at characters from the Guild War or Arena perspective, but we are seeing obviously more PvE kinds of content coming out where she really does have the potential to thrive and shine. We're going to get to more of that in just a second here. So the final grade does get skewed upward just a little bit, because she actually does have some good things going for her. It's just probably not going to change anything. And overall, definitely not a must-pull, particularly because she's in the permanent pool. You can definitely pull her very casually and build her very slowly, at least until, you know, we get that fire element global exclusive unit that most of us are clamoring for. If that happens, this might change significantly, so we'll kind of put an asterisk on that. Now, the unique evasion mechanic we're going to talk about here, on one of her passives, she has an increase to slash and missile type evasion. So if a unit uses a slash attack against her, she gets an extra 25 evasion. Same thing for missile. Honestly, kind of cool. Those are two of the more popular types of attack types. Now, when we look at the actual evasion percentages here, this is where things unfortunately really don't go well in her favor. This first column here is her evasion with passives, but we obviously want to stress test this to what you normally might see, and because of that, we're going to give the overall evasion rates of characters with 35% luck, a 17% luck subvision card, 15% luck from the trust stone as well. And when you do that, again, and I've Eldaira Sweetheart listed twice here. The top one here is if she was receiving a missile or a slash type attack, and this bottom one is if it was one of the other three types. So if she was receiving a slash or missile type, she's the most evasive you are in the game. And even against the non-slash and missile types, being as evasive as Lara Croft, Lastwell, or Halloween Leela, not the worst thing in the world, obviously definitely a step down. Here's the problem. It's a big problem. Fire does not have a 35% luck vision card, at least not yet. And so because of that, unless you have Secrets of the Heart as a main vision card on someone in your party, which again, in this stage of the game, particularly for Fire, who has no other evade units, very odd if you were to do that, unless you're trying to help boost their accuracy. So if you were to assume that you'd have Secrets of the Heart as the subvision card, I'll meet you halfway and go there, but not as the main card. So we're going to take away the 35% luck. Where does Eldaira actually end up here? 120%. This is against slash and missile types, right there with Lara Croft, way, way, way below some of the other top tier raid units in the game. And again, that's only against two types. Where does she end up against the other three types? She's about as evasive as Kingmont, Charlotte, Kane, and Engelbert and Medina against Pierce, Strike, and Magic. That is horrendous. That is not evade unit potential. So not having that 35% luck vision card to pair with the subvision card is a massive detriment to her evasion potential. Obviously, if you do put it in the main vision card, it's definitely better than this, but still you're going to lack the 17%, so it's still not going to be as good as what you're seeing on the very first chart here. But we're not done yet. There's actually a secondary wrinkle in here, which actually is kind of interesting to theory craft. She has an ability that gives a 25% chance to blind. This is the very interesting thing apart about this. Number one, it's a triple hit ability, which is cool. Number two, it's an AoE, which is extra cool. But number three, this is not your average blind. The average blind ability on many of the units is only 50% reduced accuracy. This is 80% reduced accuracy. That is a massive, massive reduction in accuracy. And one of the reasons why I would prefer to have her at 97 faith to help increase the odds of this landing. So just some very, very high level math. This is not meant to be accurate to what you might see in game, but just purely mathematically speaking. Assuming she lands the blind, I just casually built a Dark Leela build here. Now, go with me. I know Dark Leela has a 50% blind status resistance, so you're probably not going to blind her. That's not the point. The point is for the math. Leela's the most innately accurate character in the game, so I just wanted to use her for the sake of stress testing. And I put together this relatively simple dark build that you might see. And then I put together a relatively simple Eldaira build. I unfortunately forgot to post the other vision cards of the other two party members, but I did it to essentially get a rough estimate of what the luck values and whatnot would be. So, if you had a Dark Leela attacking your Eldaira, the hit rate, this is including Eldaira's 25% extra evasion because of the passive, is 131%. So Leela is definitely, definitely hitting Eldaira. If that Leela were to be blinded and have an 80% reduction in accuracy, like, that drops to not even a chance to hit. It's literally 0% chance. Because effectively what that blind does, it takes this accuracy rate and reduces it by 80%. That's nuts. So, you can understand why I put Derpy Panda as my grade as the evasion, because there's so many caveats to whether she can evade, what situation she can, and how you might want to play into it. But we'll move on to the general thoughts here for now. So, number one, she is a superb PvE unit. Let's call it what it is. She's got a triple hit, a double hit, decreased CT to the enemy on her limit break, the slow status effect in one of her subjobs. She also has decreased agility 20% on one of the subjobs, and a conditional unit resistance down of 30 as well. All of these things are fantastic additions to have for PvE content when it comes to Trials of Reckoning, definitely for the guild raids. So she's definitely a thumbs up from that perspective. She's an evade unit, but obviously very situational, as we just talked about. Not only against whether or not they have a 35% luck card or where you might put your vision cards, but also the enemy type attack and also whether or not they're blinded. A lot of things going on. She also, quite frankly, doesn't have the right vision card support. And that's not an Eldaira problem, that's a fire problem. But Eldaira in particular, because she's so drastically outside the cut of cloth of what fire is in terms of evade unit, she really just doesn't have the right vision card support to make her viable in the PvP side of things. Now, there's some AI confusion. Now, I haven't tested this myself, but I've heard from some of my guildmates that kind of ahead of me in building her that she tends to prioritize some offensive abilities in ways that you may not expect. Definitely prioritizing some of the subjob abilities, and some of that is just due to the AI preference to do the most damage. So there's probably a lot of fine tuning you have to do with the AI in order to really make her function the way you want, which isn't ideal. Does have some interesting buff varieties, at least in terms of self buff and teammate buff. So we're going to get into that in the class job overview. The Ranger sub at least brings some nice missile synergy to Cetia and the Brachiosaur card. Up to this point, Luartha was really the only fire element unit that did anything for that. So it's pretty cool that finally we have another unit that can tap into it at least. Good 97 faith potential for status effects. So as we mentioned, she has blind, she also has poison, also has immobilize, and also has slow. So all four of those things I think are important parts of her kit to really mitigate the enemy ability to act and deal damage and things of that nature. And then she does have some other good utility that I have not mentioned yet in the other bullet points here. She does have a spirit buff for allies. She also got an attack and magic break. And she also has a break physical barrier. So she does have some good things that you can use overall across a variety of different content and potential enemies. So the class and job overview. I've already talked a bunch about some of the passives and abilities, so I'm going to go through this relatively quickly. But starting with the passive abilities, there's two that I think are 95% of the time must-haves. Operative mastery in the middle here, absolutely. 12 evasion rate, you really can't compromise on that, as we were seeing with the not only the low health pool that she's going to get demolished in many instances if you're not careful, but the acquired AP is obviously very important, and so is in the slashed missile evade. I do not know a situation that you would have this off other than PvE, where you really don't need some of this. Natural instincts is another favorite of mine. That 25 accuracy is part of what makes her so accurate. The defense penetration of 40, also supremely important. But the nice thing, and one of the reasons why I did give the passives a little bit of a higher grade here, is because there is some flexibility to change some of these builds around. Operative intuition is a nice thing to have depending on the map, where you may want that extra move of one, and the decreased chance of being targeted certainly helps given how squishy she is. The ranger lore and the focus, I probably would never use focus unless you're trying to max your missile attack, which probably not going to be the majority of the time. Ranger lore at least is another accuracy buff in range of one, but at the very least there's some interesting things to play with depending upon how maps change, that you can have certain maps where she gets some extra range or extra move, and you kind of fine tune her AI that way. From the counter perspective, love that she has reflex here. That's obviously one of the best counters in the game and really important to her survivability for certain. But that one's probably a little less prevalent given the amount of reduced counter chance that we see in the game with Dark Leela and the dagger that came out and some of the passives that we have now in the Trust Stone. So it's still an A grade, but it's definitely not as oppressive as it might have been at one time. Now for the main job, one thing to keep in mind on all of these is that her mastery ability is a reduced AP cost of 10%. So these are all technically 10% cheaper, not only the main job, but also the sub job. So Reaping Edge is a very interesting one. It's definitely a little more potent than your average, you know, first skill, but 17 AP with kind of this weird shape range. I'm sure it has some of its benefits in terms of positioning, but overall, pretty lackluster. Blinding Trinity, this is that blind effect that is, in my opinion, one of the best abilities in her kit. It's not only the triple hit, also the 80% reduced accuracy, also the AoE, so fantastic things there. Toxic Assault, I don't like this one at all. This is a one square ability, as far as I can tell, that has a 65% chance to inflict poison. Now, granted, amazing modifier on it at 205, but the fact that the poison gets reduced every single time you get hit, kind of odd too, and she's not going to take a lot of hits to begin with, so it probably doesn't matter. But overall, I just think it's subpar to some of the other abilities in our kit here, and just going through again the other offensive abilities, Fight of Bind is basically the one that I prefer to Toxic Assault. Only 5% less than the modifier. It's only one more AP, so it ends up being basically the same. But the odds to actually immobilize a character with way better ranged attack potential, in addition to the unit resistance down, I think is very, very impactful. Now for the buffs, Subterfuge I actually like a lot, that it's a teammate buff, that it does increase the evasion rate of 25 for herself and allies, and reduces the chance of her being targeted. Two really great things. So I like the fact that even if you can increase her movement, she has the jump, you have a buff that she can go to a teammate for. And then Shadow Flux, very, very good ability here, where reduces the damage taken by 30% three times for self, not three turns, very important distinction. Increases agility of 25% perpetually until she receives two hits, which again, she has a high base agility, so that's actually very, very impactful for how speedy she is. And it further increases her slash attack resistance penetration of 30, which is a big damage increase for her and she kind of needs. So overall, I really like both of those buffs. Now for the operative sub job, the Drain Zone, although I just said earlier she doesn't really have any reliable healing mechanics, this kind of counts, but not really. The AI may not prioritize it given the modifier that it has here and whether or not you have multiple enemies in the space. This ability is okay. The Disinformation to me is a very, very good PvE ability again as well, with a decreased agility of 20%. Because it's a TP skill with no damage, I think the reliability that it gets used in actual PvP content certainly diminished given some of the other abilities that she has. But overall, the decreased accuracy of 25 is also super important. If this actually is an ability that she will regularly use, and there's a very good chance that she might, given the range of this, I mean, it's absolutely massive in terms of how far she can hit. If you look at the previous page here, although she has some ranged abilities, they're not nearly the range of Disinformation. This actually is a very good buff. If she can get it off, it will go a long way to helping her evasion. Now, on the other sub job, though, Strider, this is one of the other ones that I particularly like. This is the one that has the attack buff and spear buff for allies. Certainly situational, but at least nice to have. This is the other sub job that has another double hit on it. This is where the slow is. This is where the physical barrier break and the attack and magic debuff are. This is definitely a good sub job to still play with. And finally, it brings you to the Ranger sub job, which she does have access to Sharpshoot and Barrage, which is technically going to be 10% cheaper. Always nice. The one thing I'm very, very interested in seeing in terms of AI prioritization, this is obviously very hard, very map dependent, but vigilance is a very interesting thing. But 55% extra evasion for one turn is interesting considering that she really needs it. Now, given what we've seen for the other buffs so far, particularly that she has two potential teammate buffs if you have them on, very much doubt that this will be a regular occurrence, but something to remember, at least if you're doing manual PvP, even at least, that's a very, very big evasion increase that she certainly would appreciate. And finally, we get into the limit break, the TMR, and the mastery. So the limit break, this is a very good limit break. It's a very, very large AoE, decreases CT for all the targets, essentially cuts it in half, while also increasing her own CT gauge by 25 out of the 100. Definitely a great ability, no doubt about it, particularly when you consider what her agility value might already be in terms of turn order. This is definitely a thumbs up. Now for the TMR, I am in love with this TMR. I think this is a fantastic TMR. Not only is it an accessory, so I really like TMRs that are great that are accessories because there's so many good cloths and armors. These are some really great stats though on it. Now the HP aside, 7 defense, 5 agility, 10 crit evade. Love all three of those, the agility in particular, obviously. But the TMR skill I'm also in love with. I think this is fantastic. There's obviously a couple TMRs that give move one, jump one. Ketone's TMR is one that comes to mind. But the increase unit resistance of 30 for 3 turns, I love that. I think that's so uniquely impactful in addition to the extra mobility it gives a unit when you consider how mobile she already potentially is. I think it's a fantastic TMR, not only for her, but a wide variety of other content as well. Definitely 2 thumbs up. Finally, the mastery ability we saw earlier, attack 15% to the stats and the AP consumption decrease of 10% overall. Really great mastery ability, I'll give her that. Then we get into the notable vision cards. This is where the pain point is, because fire just really doesn't have that many. The de facto kind of best one for me would be the Brachiosaur, if only because it does have some really great unit buffs that she's really going to like. Maybe not going to get much benefit out of the missile attack if you don't have the Ranger job on, obviously, but gives agility to the party and herself, and the unit resistance is very, very important to me. This is still a very good card. There's kind of a big drop off after that, and it really just dabbles in a lot of the MR cards, which are fine but not preferable at differing levels of PvP. I do think Birth, whatever it's called, the MR card here, this is at least HP for the unit. It is a luck card, technically 21%, so not nearly as high as the 35% or what you'd get on a subvision card, but it also gives 15% unit resistance, so not the worst thing. This is not a good subvision card, in my opinion. You'd have to have it as your main vision card, which is kind of why Fire's in a rough balance spot. I also think Death Machine, obviously a good vision card too, but I would prefer to have it on Mont or whatever other tank you're using potentially. And then finally, the Lilith MR card here as well. This gives Eldira 10 defense, party slash attack, and magic resistance, which again, if you're going to jack up your Faith 97, the magic resistance certainly helps as well. So not the worst thing. And then technically, the Merilith card's not bad either. You can see kind of the struggle Fire is having at the moment with the vision cards and why that potential global exclusive fire unit and the global exclusive vision card they would likely come with are very hotly anticipated. There is one caveat though, obviously, given she's an evade unit, Secrets of the Heart definitely does still have a place as the main vision card. I can't really have a good argument why you may not put it on, but it also opens a conversation that I think is kind of interesting in this new age of War of the Visions that we're seeing, is her potential in a rainbow comp. If you were to theoretically pair her with maybe some of the evade earth units, if you recall, she's got a teammate buff that increases evasion by 25. If you find a way that she can, be in an earth comp that uses Secrets of the Heart on the main vision card, and she can go buff Immortals is on for 25 extra evasion or something to that effect, and obviously you have like a pocket healer or maybe someone else to tank and take the heat off her, I see no reason why she may not be viable. We keep downplaying the fire element and how Mont's powercraft and the vision cards are old and they have a weird identity now between magic users and brawl and slow units and fast units. Like, well, you know what? If that's the case, then take her out of the fire. Put her in a rainbow comp. I haven't done enough testing to see if it's viable. My gut says probably not. But at this point, I think she probably has a better chance of succeeding in one of these than she does in your generic fire comp. Take from that what you will. Finally, the trust zone recommendations. The luck is like definitely a must. And she, in my opinion, is the first unit I've ever thought of that I actually might prefer the evade instead, where technically this will be up to 18 evasion with the main stats on the trust stones. She's already accurate enough that the actual accuracy from the luck really isn't going to put her over the edge per se, but the extra evasion here certainly might. We've seen how much she can struggle with that potentially. In terms of out of the ordinary passives, they're obviously luck 10%, HP 10% are a must. But I could see a case where you might want to throw in the pierce resistance and the strike resistance here. Again, God help you if you're using the resources to max these to 7% for a unit that's very much potentially subpar. But when you consider that she might be taking these hits and doesn't evade them as well, to have that extra resistance certainly is going to mitigate some of the damage. Now, on the right side of things, AP and attack, definitely the go-tos for physical damage dealers. I am partial to the AP one for DPS in terms of the decrease in AP consumption and starting AP here, where she also has the decrease of AP consumption in part of the mastery. It will stack. Being able to get that extra ability off is very, very powerful, way more than a couple extra 100 damage, in my opinion. And in terms of the other one, I love the agility one here too. The agility set I think would be so, so impactful on her to not only give her that extra 6 agility, which she's already going to be very speedy with, but the extra 5 evasion rate, definitely every little bit helps for her, as we've seen. And in terms of passives that are a little out of the ordinary on the right side that you might want to hunt for, it's really just the acquired AP of 20%. I think that's really, really potentially powerful because she doesn't have many cheap abilities, although she does have AP consumption, you know, reductions. They're still your average to above average cost, so I think that certainly helps. And that's Sweetheart Eldaira in a nutshell. Definitely an intriguing character. I think we have to temper our expectations overall for what she's going to do. Definitely not going to be changing the game at all whatsoever. That being said, we are obviously on the cusp of a new global exclusive unit, and if it ends up being a awesome fire unit Oberyn level carry with a 35% luck vision card, well shoot, this character review is going to probably have to be redone because it's going to change everything. So there's some hope to be had. I'm glad that Gumi is thinking outside the box a little bit, even if it doesn't stick the landing. The fact that they can kind of do some unique things with the character, think outside the box, I think is a good thing to at least strive for. And even if it might be a miss on Eldaira here in the broad scheme of things, overall her introduction to the game does still have some great benefits with the addition of a fantastic TMR and some excellent PvE potential for the fire element units. So that's the review. Thanks so much for watching. Those of you who have had some experience with her, feel free to drop your experiences in the comment section. Always appreciate to see that feedback live, particularly because I haven't had a chance to do it myself yet. But that's all for now. I'll talk to you all soon.